Panchadasi by Sri Vidyaranya Swami is being continued. Chapter 9, The Lamp of Meditation. 1. One may perchance obtain a thing by following a wrong line by mistake. So also, even by worshipping Brahman, one may get release, the desired goal. So various ways of worship are described in the Nrisimha Uttaratapaniya Upanishad. 2. A man sees a gleam of light emitted by a gem, and another sees a gleam of light coming from a lamp, and both, imagining that they are gems, run to get them. Though in both the cases the notions are wrong, the results are different. 3. There is a lamp inside the house. Its light is visible from outside. Similarly, elsewhere, the light of a gem is seen from outside. 4. On seeing the two gleams at a distance, both the men took them for gems and ran after them. Their notions are equally wrong in that they took the gleams for gems. 5. The man who ran for the gleam of the lamp did not find the gem, but the man who ran for the gleam of the gem got it. 6. Mistaking the gleam of a lamp for a gem is called a visamvadi brahma, misleading error, or an error that does not lead to the goal. Mistaking the gleam of a gem for a gem is called a leading or informative error, though both are errors or wrong observations. 7. On seeing a mist and mistaking it for smoke, if a man argues the existence of a fire there and goes for getting charcoal and accidentally finds it, his mistake is called a leading error, a chance coincidence. 8. Sprinkling on himself the water of the river Godavari, thinking it to be that of the river Ganges, if a man is actually purified, this is leading error, samvadi brahma. 9. A man suffering from a high fever repeats Narayana in delirium and dies. He goes to heaven. This is again a leading error. 10. In direct perception, in inference, and in the application of scriptural authority, there are innumerable instances of such leading errors or chance coincidences. 11. Otherwise, how could images of clay, wood, and stone be worshipped as deities, or how would a woman be worshipped as fire? 12. From the knowledge or adaptation of a wrong means, sometimes by accident, as in the sitting of a crow on the branch of a palm tree, and in the instantaneous fall of a fruit thereof, a desired result is obtained. This knowledge and or adoption of a wrong means is called a samvadi brahma, or a leading error, or error leading to a right knowledge. 13. The leading error, though a wrong notion, is potent enough to give the correct result. So also, the meditation or worship of Brahman leads to liberation. 14. After indirectly knowing the one invisible homogeneous Brahmin from the books on Vedanta, one should meditate on or think repeatedly, I am Brahman. 15. Without realizing Brahman to be one's own self, the general knowledge of him derived through the study of the scriptures, that is, Brahman, is here called indirect knowledge, just as our knowledge of the forms of Vishnu, etc., is called. 16. One may have knowledge of Vishnu from scriptures as having four arms, etc., but if one does not have a vision of him, he is said to have only indirect knowledge, inasmuch as he has not seen him with his eyes. 17. This knowledge, because of its defect of indirectness, is not false, for the true form of Vishnu has been revealed by the scriptures, which are authoritative. 18. From the scripture, a man may have a conception of Brahman as existence, consciousness, and bliss, but he cannot have a direct knowledge of Brahman unless Brahman is cognized as the inner witness in his own personality. 19. As the knowledge of Satchit Ananda has been acquired in the scriptural method, it, though an indirect knowledge, is not an illusory one. 20. Though Brahman has been described as being one's own self in the scriptures and the great sayings, still one cannot understand it without the practice of inquiry. 21. As long as the delusion that the body is the self is strong in a man of dull intellect. He is not able to once to know Brahman as the self. 22. As the perception of duality is not opposed to an indirect knowledge of non-duality, a man of faith, expert in the scriptures, can easily have the indirect knowledge of Brahman. 23. The perception of a stone image is not opposed to an indirect knowledge of the deity whom the image represents, which devotee contradicts the idea of Vishnu in the image. 24. The disbelief of those who have no faith need not be considered, for the believing alone are authorized to perform the Vedic actions. 25. An indirect knowledge of Brahman can arise even though a single instruction by a competent teacher. It is like the knowledge of the form of Vishnu, which does not depend on intellectual inquiry. 26. As there may be doubt about them, ritualistic works and methods of worship have been discussed in the scriptures. Who otherwise could have synthesized the directions about them scattered as they are over many branches of the Vedas? 27. Such rituals and methods of worship have been collected and coordinated in the Kalpa Sutra. With their help, man who has faith may practice them without further inquiry. 28. The methods of worship are described in other works by the seers. Those who are dull of ratiocination go to a teacher and learn the methods from him. 29. To determine the correct meaning of the Vedic texts, let the learned resort to inquiry, but practical worship can be performed with benefit according to the teachings of a competent teacher. 30. The direct realization of Brahman, however, is never possible only from the instructions of a competent teacher without the practice of inquiry. 31. Want of faith alone obstructs the indirect knowledge. Want of inquiry is, however, the obstacle to the direct knowledge. 32. If even by inquiry one does not get the direct knowledge of Brahman as the self, one should repeatedly practice inquiry, for inquiry, it is prescribed, should continue until direct knowledge dawns. 33. If a person does not realize the self even after practicing till death, he will surely realize it in a future life when all the obstacles will have been eliminated. 34. Knowledge will arise either in this birth or the next, says the author of the Brahma Sutras. The Shruti also says that there are many who listen to the teachings on non-duality and yet do not realize in this life. 35. But by virtue of the practice of spiritual inquiry in a previous birth, Vamadeva had realization even while in his mother's womb. Such results are also seen in the case of studies. 36. In spite of reading many times, a boy may not be able to memorize something, but sometimes next morning, without any further study, he remembers all that he had read. 37. As the seed in the field or in the womb matures in time, so in the course of time, the practice of self-inquiry gradually ripens and bears fruits. 38. In spite of repeated inquiry, a man does not realize the truth because of three kinds of impediments. This has been clearly pointed out in his Vartika by Acharya Sureshwara. 39. If you ask why the realization which did not arise before comes now, we shall repay that knowledge comes only with the total removal of impediments which may be past, present or future. 40. Therefore, only by studying the Veda and its meaning a man is not released. This has been shown in the example of hidden gold. 41. There is the popular song saying that a monk could not realize the truth, the impediment being his past attachment to his queen or a she buffalo. 42. His teacher instructed him of Brahman, knowing his attachment to her, by telling him that Brahman was her substratum. When the impediment was removed, the monk realized the truth properly. 43. The impediments of the present are binding attachment to the object of the senses, dullness of the intellect, indulgences in improper and illogical arguments, and the deep conviction that the self is an agent and an enjoyer. 44. Through the practice of inner control and other qualifications, and through hearing the truth and so forth, suitable for counteracting the impediments, the latter slowly perish and one realizes his self as Brahman. 45. The future impediments has been well illustrated in the case of Vamadeva. He overcame it in one birth and Bharata in three births. 46. In the Gita, it has been told that a yogi who has not attained illumination in this life may be freed from the impediment after many births, yet his practice of inquiry is never fruitful, is never fruitless. 47. Because of his practice of inquiry, such a yogi enters into the heaven of the meritorious, and then if he is not freed from desires, he is born again in a pious and prosperous family. 48. Or if he has no worldly desire, he is born in a family of yogis who have pure intellect due to their practice of inquiry into the nature of Brahman, for such a birth is hard to obtain. 49. He regains the yogic intellect acquired in his previous birth and so strives more vigorously. His birth is indeed hard to achieve. 50. He is borne on by the momentum of his yogic practices in the previous birth even against his inclination. Thus, after many births, he achieves perfection and as a result is liberated. 51. A man who has a strong desire for Brahmaloka but suppresses it and practices inquiry about the self will not have realization. 52. As the scriptures say, the monk who has well ascertained the meaning of Vedanta goes to the realm of Brahma and is released at the end of the four yugas along with Brahma. 53. In some cases, the inquiry itself is impeded because of the result of their evil deeds, as the Shruti says. Even to hear about him, it is not available to many. 54. If a man cannot practice inquiry, either due to extreme dullness of intellect or for want of other favorable circumstances, let him always keep the mind on Brahman. 55. As it is possible to continue the thought current regarding Brahman with attributes, meditation on the attributeless Brahman also is not impossible. 56. Doubt. Brahman is beyond speech and mind and so cannot be meditated upon. Reply. Then there can be no knowledge of Brahman too. 57. Doubt. Brahman is known as beyond speech and mind. Reply. Then why cannot Brahman be meditated upon as beyond speech and mind? 58. Doubt. If Brahman can be meditated upon, he becomes invested with attributes. Reply. That happens if he is taken as knowable. Doubt. Brahman is knowable by Lakshana, indirect indication. Reply. Then meditate upon Brahman that way, that is by Lakshana. 59. Doubt. The Shruti is saying, know that alone to be Brahman which is beyond the range of speech and mind and not that which the people worship, prohibits meditation on Brahman. 60. Reply. Equally, Brahman cannot be an object of knowledge. For the Shruti says, Brahman is other than that which can be known. Doubt. The Shruti also says that Brahman can be known. Reply. So also it says that he can be meditated upon. So meditate on him, basing upon those Vedic texts. 61. Doubt. But Brahman as an object of knowledge is unreal. Reply. Why not as an object of meditation too? Doubt. Covering and apprehending by vrittis is knowledge. Reply. Similarly, doing that is meditation. 62. Doubt. Why are you so devoted to meditation on the attributeless Brahman? Reply. Why are you so opposed to it? Say that as there are many Shruti texts prescribing meditation on the attributeless Brahman, it is not proper to say that there is no authority for it. 63. 3. Meditation on the attributeless Brahman has been prescribed in the Nrisimha Uttaratapaniya Prashna, Saibhya's fifth question, Katha, Mandukya and other Upanishads. 64. This method of meditation of the attributeless Brahman has been in the Panchikarana Vartika by Sureshwara. Doubt. This meditation is a means of indirect knowledge of Brahman, but not of liberation. Reply. We do not say that it is not so. 65. Doubt. But most of the people do not practice this type of meditation. Reply. Let them not do. How can the meditation be blamed for the shortcomings of the meditator? 66. People of spiritual dull intellect repeat sacred formulas to acquire power over others, finding it more immediately fruitful than meditation on Brahman with attributes. There are people still more dull-witted who concentrate only on agriculture. 67. Let the dull-witted do what they like. Here we speak of meditation on the absolute. Since it is of one vidya or upasana, all the qualifications of Brahman described in the various branches of the Veda must be gathered for meditation. 68. The positive qualities of bliss, etc., are all to be coordinated into meditation on Brahman. This has been told by Vyasa in the Anandaya Sutra. 69. Similarly, Vyasa speaks of all the negative indications of Brahman, such as not gross, in the Aksharadhyam Sutra. 70. Doubt. Coming and thinking of these indications do not fit in with meditation on the attributeless Brahman. Reply. Then your doubt is directed against Vyasa himself and not against me alone. 71. Doubt. As Vyasa has not asked for the inclusion of the forms such as of the sun with golden beard, etc., meditation on the attributeless is not contradicted. Reply. Be satisfied with that. We also do not ask for that. 72. Doubt. Qualities are only indirect indications. They cannot enter into the true nature of Brahman. Reply. Let them be so. Meditate on Brahman thus indicated. 73. The self is here indirectly indicated by positive qualities like bliss, etc., and by negative qualities like not gross, etc. One should meditate on the invisible homogeneous self as that I am. 74. Doubt. What is the difference between knowledge and meditation? Reply. Listen. Knowledge depends on the object, whereas meditation depends on the will of the person meditating. 76. By the practice of inquiry, the knowledge of Brahman arises. Then it cannot be prevented whether one likes it or not. Such knowledge, by the mere fact of its arising, destroys all ideas of the reality of the world. 76. On acquiring knowledge, the aspirant experiences unbroken satisfaction and a feeling of having accomplished all that was to be accomplished. He becomes liberated in life and awaits the wearing out of his fructifying karma. 77. On the other hand, a believing man putting his faith in the teachings of his teacher and without practicing inquiry should meditate on the object prescribed without being distracted by other thoughts. 78. He should continue the practice of meditation until he realizes himself to be identical with his object of meditation and then continues this thought till death. 79. A certain brahmachari used to go for alms, keeping in his mind his identity with the vital air within him. 80. Meditation depends on the will of a man, whether he is to do or not to do, or to do it in a different way. One should therefore always continue the thought current. 81. A student diligent in reciting the Vedas reads or recites them even in his dreams through the force of habit. Similarly, one who practices meditation continues it even in his dream. 82. Giving up contrary thoughts, if a man ceaselessly meditates, he meditates even in his dreams because of the deep impression. 83. There is no doubt that while experiencing the results of his fructifying karma, a man, because of his strong impression, is able to meditate without intermission. just as a man attached to worldly objects always thinks of them. 84. A woman devoted to a paramount, though engaged in household duties, will all the time be dwelling in mind on the pleasures with him. 85. While enjoying in mind the pleasures of the company of her lover, her household duties, though not much disturbed, are managed indifferently. 86. The woman with attachment to a paramour cannot fully do the work as a woman attached to her domestic duties does with enthusiasm. 87. Similarly, a man who practices meditation one-pointedly, indifferently, performs his worldly affairs, but a man who has realized the truth fulfills his worldly duties well, as they do not come in conflict with his knowledge. 88. This world is illusory Maya, and the self is by nature pure consciousness. How can such knowledge be opposed to his worldly activities? 89. To perform activities, the world need not be thought real nor self as insentient matter. To do so, the right means only are necessary. 90. These means are the mind, the speech, body, and eternal objects. They do not disappear on the enlightenment. So why cannot he engage himself in worldly affairs? 91. If he controls and concentrates his mind, he is a meditator and not a knower of truth. To know a pot, the mind need not be controlled. 92. Doubt. A pot once known by a modification of intellect, vritti, remains so always. Reply. Is not the self-illumined self also ever manifest? 93. Doubt. Does the self-luminous property of the self give you the knowledge of Brahman? The vritti with Brahman as the object is the cognition of truth, but the vritti perishes in a moment. Reply. This objection also applies to the cognition of a pot. 94. Once an intellectual conviction of the pot's existence is established, the cognition vritti of the pot perishes. Afterwards, it can be recognized at the will of the cognizer. Reply. The same applies to the cognition of the self. 95. Once the nature of the self has been conclusively determined, the knower who can speak of it, think of it, or meditate on it at will. 96. Doubt. The knower too, like a meditator, forgets worldly affairs in his contemplation. Reply. Let him forget. This forgetfulness is due to his meditation and not because of his knowledge of the self. 97. Meditation is left to his will, for his release has been achieved through knowledge. From knowledge alone comes release. This the scriptures announce with drum beats. 98. Doubt. If a knower does not meditate, he would be drawn to external affairs. Reply. Let him happily engage himself in them. What is the objection for a knower to be so engaged? 99. Doubt. This sort of reasoning is wrong, for there the scriptures will be violated. Reply. If so, what is right reasoning, please? Doubt. Right reasoning is to follow the injunctions and prohibitions of the scriptures. Reply. But they do not apply to the enlightened. 100. All these injunctions and prohibitions are meant for those who believe themselves to belong to a certain caste or station and stage of life. 101. The knower is convinced that caste, station, etc. are creations of Maya and that they refer to the body and not to the self whose nature is pure consciousness. 102. The clear-sight knower from whose heart all attachment has vanished is a liberated soul, whether he performs or not concentration or action. 103. He whose mind is free from all desires or former impressions has nothing to gain from either action or inaction, meditation, samadhi, or repetition of holy formulas. 104. The self is associationless, and everything other than the self is a display of the magic of Maya. When a mind has such a firm conviction, where from will any desire or impression come in it? 105. Thus, when for an illumined sage there is no injunction or on prohibition, where is his violating them? Only for him can violation be possible who is bound by them. 106. As a child is not subject to any injunctions and prohibitions, he cannot be charged with their violation. In their absence, in the case of a man of realization too, how can there be any violation? 107. Doubt. But a boy does not know anything. Reply. A knower of truth knows everything. The law applies to one who knows a little, not to the other two. 108. Doubt. He is a knower of truth who can bless or curse with effect. Reply. Not that, for these powers result from the practice of austerities. 109. Doubt. Vyasa and others had these powers. Reply. But these were produced by some austerities. Austerities meant for knowledge are different from them. 110. Those who practice both the types of austerities possess both powers and knowledge. So each type of practice will produce the result appropriate to it. 111. Doubt. Ascetics and ritualistics despise the saintly monk who has neither such powers nor follow the injunctions. Reply. Their austerities and rituals are also despised by the votaries of worldly pleasures. 112. Doubt. Monks too find a pleasure in the acquisition of arms, clothes and shelter. Reply. Then what wonderful renunciation they must have been unable to move as it were with their dispassion. 113. Doubt. It does not matter if the ritualists observing the scriptural rules are abused by the ignorant. Reply. It also does not matter if a man of recognition is abused by the ritualists who identify themselves with the body and so observe the rules. 114. Therefore, his knowledge of truth does not affect the means such as the mind and so forth. A man of realization is able to do worldly activities such as ruling a country. 115. Doubt. He may not have any desire for worldly affairs, since he is convinced of the unreality of the ephemeral world. Reply. Let it be. Let him be engaged in meditation or work according to his fructifying karma. 116. On the other hand, a meditator should always engage himself in meditation, for through meditation his feeling of identity with Brahman arises, as a devotee has it by meditating on Vishnu. 117. The feeling of identity, which is the effect of meditation, ceases when the practice is given up. But the true Brahminhood does not vanish even in the absence of knowledge. 118. The eternal Brahminhood is revealed by knowledge and not created by it. For even in the absence of the revealer, the real entity does not cease to exist. 119. Doubt. But the Brahmanhood of a meditator also is real. Reply. True. Is not the Brahmanhood of the ignorant and the lower creatures also real? 120. Since nescience is common, they do not realize the purpose of their life. But just as begging is better than starving, so also it is better to practice devotion and meditation than to engage in other pursuits. 121. It is better to perform the works ordained in the scriptures than be engrossed in worldly affairs. Better than this is to worship a personal deity, and meditation on the attributeless Brahman is still better. 122. That which is nearer to the realization of Brahman is superior, and meditation on the absolute gradually becomes like direct realization of Brahman. 123. A leading error leads to the desired goal when it becomes knowledge. Similarly, meditation on Brahman, when ripened, leads to release and becomes real knowledge. 124. Doubt. A man working prompted by a leading error gets correct knowledge not by the leading error but by another evidence. Reply. The meditation on the absolute may also be taken as the cause of other evidence. Nididhyasana leading to direct realization. 125. Doubt. Meditation on the form of a deity and repetition of a sacred formula also lead to the goal. Reply. Let it be so. But the speciality of meditation on the absolute is that it is nearest to the goal of self-realization. 126. When meditation on the attributeless Brahman is mature, it leads to samadhi. This state of intense concentration at ease leads on to the Nirodha state, in which the distinction between subject and object is eliminated. 127. When such complete cessation of mental activity is achieved, only the associationless entity Atman remains in his heart. By ceaseless meditation on it based on the great sayings arises the knowledge, I am Brahman. 128. There is then a perfect realization of Brahman as the immutable, associationless, eternal, self-revealed, secondless whole as indicated in the scriptures. 129. The Amrita Bindu and other Upanishads recommend yoga for the same subject. It is clear, therefore, that meditation on the attributeless Brahman is superior to other types of worship. 130. Those who give up meditation on the attributeless Brahman and undertake pilgrimages, recitations of the holy formulas and other methods may be compared to those who drop the sweets and lick the hand. 131. Doubt. This applies also to those who meditate on the attributeless Brahman, giving up inquiry into its nature. Reply. True. Therefore, only those who are not able to practice inquiry have been asked to meditate on the attributeless Brahman. 132. Those who are very fickle-minded and agitated do not have the knowledge of Brahman by the practice of inquiry. Therefore, control of the mind is the chief means for them. By it, their mind becomes free from distractions. 133. For those whose intellects are no longer distracted nor restless but are merely covered by a veil of ignorance, the analytical system called Sankhya, intellectual inquiry, is prescribed. It will quickly lead them to spiritual illumination. 134. The state of spiritual balance is obtained by both the Sankhyas, those who follow the path of inquiry, and the yogis, those who practice meditation. He really knows the meaning of the scriptures, who knows that the path of inquiry and meditation are the same. 135. The Shruti too declares that with both inquiry and meditation, people know the highest. But whatever in the books of Sankhya and Yoga are against the Shruti are to be rejected. 136. If one fails to perfect the practice of meditation in this life, one does so either at the time of death or in the region of Brahman. Then, obtaining direct knowledge of the reality, one is liberated. 137. The Gita says that a man attains that which he thinks of at the time of death. Wherever his mind is fixed, there he goes, says the Shruti too. 138. So the future life of a man is determined by the nature of his thoughts at the time of death. Then, as a devotee of the personal God is absorbed in him, so a meditator on the attributeless Brahman is absorbed in it and obtains liberation. 139. Brahman is called eternal and attributeless, but in fact it is of the nature of liberation itself. Just as leading error is an error in name only, for it leads to the desired object. 140. As my meditation on the personal God, knowledge of the nature of Ishvara arises, so by meditation on the attributeless Brahman, knowledge of its nature arises and destroys the ignorance which is the root of rebirth. 141. A meditator becomes Brahman who is unattached, desireless, free from body and organs and fearless. Thus, the Tapaniya Upanishad speaks of liberation as the result of meditation on the attributeless Brahman. 142. By the strength of meditation on the attributeless Brahman, knowledge arises. So, the scriptural verse, "Verily, there is no other path to liberation except knowledge," does not conflict with this. 143. So, the Tapaniya Upanishad points out that liberation comes from desireless meditation. The Prashna Upanishad also says that by meditation with desire, one enters the region of Brahma. 144. The Prashna Upanishad says that he who meditates with desires on the three-lettered Om is taken to the region of Brahma. There he comes to know the attributeless Brahman who is beyond Hiranyagarbha, the sum total of souls, and becomes free. 145. The Brahma Sutras in the Apratikadhi Karana says that he who desires the region of Brahma and meditates with desires on the attributeless Brahman attains that region. 146. Such a worshipper, by virtue of his meditation on the attributeless Brahman, enters the world of Brahma and there obtains direct knowledge of Brahman. He is not born again. He gets ultimate release at the end of the four yugas. 147. In the Vedic meditation on the holy syllable Om, in most places means meditation on the attributeless Brahman, though in some places it means meditation on Brahman with attributes. 148. Pipalada, being asked by his pupil Satyakama, says that Om means Brahman both with and without attributes. 149. Yama, too questioned by his pupil Nachiketa, replied that he who meditates on Om, knowing it as the attributeless Brahman, obtains the fulfillment of his desires. 150. He who meditates properly on the attributeless Brahman gets direct knowledge of Brahman, either in this life or at the time of death or in the world of Brahma. 151. The Atma Gita also clearly says that those who cannot practice discrimination should always meditate on the self. 152. The self as if says, even if direct knowledge of me does not seem to be possible, a man should still meditate on the self. In the course of time, he doubtlessly realizes the self and is freed. 153. To reach treasures deeply hidden in the earth, there is nothing for it but to dig. So, to have direct knowledge of me, the self, there is no other means that meditation on one's. There is no other means than meditation on one's self. 154. A man should remove the stones of body consciousness from the field of the mind, and then by repeatedly digging with the pickaxe, the intellect, he can get the hidden treasure of the self. 155. Even if there is no realization, think I am Brahman. Through meditation, a man achieves even other things like the deities. Why not Brahman, who is ever achieved? 156. If a man who is convinced by his experience that meditation practiced day by day destroys the idea that the non-self is the self, nevertheless becomes idle and neglects meditation, what difference, tell us, is there between him and a brute? 157. Destroying his idea that the body is the self through meditation, a man sees the secondless self, becomes immortal, and realizes Brahman in this body itself. 158. The meditator who studies this chapter called the lamp of meditation is freed from all his doubts and meditates constantly on Brahman. Chapter 9 completed. Om Namah Shivaya.